tragedy. So he has admitted. You can look this up. Don't take my word for it. Look up John McCain and his connection to ISIS. John McCain admitted he's got everyday contact with ISIS. America's proxy army, NATO's BT, all these morally retarded teenagers that they've given machine guns and told to go kill people. So of course, if they're coming into Europe, they're gonna start shit. Obviously, this is Satan's own. So what do you say if you're in Europe? What should United Germany do? The answer is simple. What is the source of the problem? The source of the problem is the United States. It's sponsoring ISIS. It's a corporation headquartered in the United States and Sierra Vista, Arizona. White House on Fort Huachuca. Now, what do you do? Your enemy's the United States. If you're Europe, here's your solution. Your root of the problem is the United States. The enemy army's headquartered in the United States. To protect Europe, declare war on the United States. Institute regime change. Invade the United States and introduce a different form of government. Deconstruct its military completely, because that's their form of government. That's what Europe should do. That's my answer to that. That is the answer. If you're Europe, if you were running Europe, if you're United Germany, Chancellor Schmidt, or whatever her name is, the only trained scientist to ever run a nation state since Japan's Emperor Hirohito, who was a trained marine biologist. Now, I understand that perhaps the Iron Lady who ran England was also a scientist. There was a scientist who ran Poland for a short time before he was assassinated. He almost doesn't count. He was in charge for about 24 hours. But other than that, it was only Britain and Germany. And, of course, we've got Japan that have had scientists who have ruled their nations. Germany is one of them. And what she should do is she should declare war on the United States and institute regime change. Send in a force to invade Washington, D.C., deconstruct the United States military, get its demobilization going. That's the only way to prevent this from overwhelming Europe. That really should be done in the name of the Schutzstaffel as the defenders of the European continent and the separate but equal nations. That was the tradition of the Waffen-SS and its deployment and its organization. That is what needs to be done. So, there you have it. That should end this for tonight. Give everybody enough to think about as food for thought.
That certainly is a ton of information, Douglas. If you would, give our listeners a way to contact you.
Sure, certainly. I do want people to contact me through Facebook. My Facebook community fan page is facebook.com/DouglasDwayneDietrich. Douglas spelled with one S. Dwayne, my middle name, is spelled D-U-A-N-E. My surname is spelled, just put the words diet and rich together, D-I-E-T-R-I-C-H. Make certain that Facebook.com, Douglas Dwayne Dietrich, that you put a like on that page so I don't have to continue to pay to maintain it and its continuity. You can friend me personally on Facebook through Facebook.com/DouglasDDietrich at my Facebook friends page. And look up my Executrix producer, Laura Lee Solomon, and contact her. Her Skype ID is Laura Lee Solomon, her full name, LauraLeeSolomon. And Laura Lee Solomon, you can Skype friend her either prior to a transmission when we're going on air for the Saturday Night Firing Lines, then Skype in during the Saturday Night Firing Lines. We'll bring you in on air. You can ask me any question you want, including how to contact me or reach my Executrix producer, etc. And also, you can contact her via Skype. Leave her a message in the Skype text box and tell her that you want to contact myself or purchase DVDs. We're making them ourselves now, just burning them off individually per each order. And, of course, anybody can contact her, Laura Lee Solomon, by looking her up on Facebook, amongst my friends list on the Facebook timeline, etc. There's ways that you can find me when you put your mind to it, and I certainly appreciate people looking me up. So probably the most efficient way is through that Skype. And my Executrix producer, Laura Lee Solomon. That's probably the safest and most effective and fastest way. So I want to thank Mr. Rex Baer for giving me the opportunity to bring that up with people. One of these days, maybe our next interview, we can go into a bit about why my website is down, what was going on with my former manageress, who I'm now separated with, and certainly have terminated her in terms of any semi-professional affiliation that we had.
So that had to be done in terms of my own ongoing struggles with the United States government as a whistleblower. And of course, we have a situation that I always have to be very careful of whom I affiliate with. I was certainly, I'll contextualize how that came about in terms of semi-professional affiliation with herself the next time that Mr. Rexburn and I speak, and hopefully we'll speak semi-regularly as the future progresses. I wish him all the best with the LEAK project. Very important that at some point in the future we'll contextualize exactly my background as a whistleblower and a public informant, and exactly what I did with the Department of Defense, etc. And certainly, I guess the only other thing that comes to mind is, once again, a shout out to Carol Mostreet, who originally brought that photograph of the individual who's being touted as Michael Aquino, who is sitting with the senior Bush and Bill Clinton. That is a genuine photograph. It is not Photoshop. It's not a hoax. The individual in there is almost certainly not Michael Aquino. There is a hoax photograph, again, to warn people about, of Anton LaVey, the founder of the First Church of Satan, with Senator John Kerry. That is a hoax. But this one is not, I argue it's not Colonel Aquino, who probably would consider it beneath his dignity or his need to even sit with men like Bush and the senior and Bill Clinton. And it will instead present to you the dangers that are far more immediate that I have. And also, as I said, Kara Mastry relayed that photograph to me. Make sure to check out the Tawn Mastry Foundation, established in name of her sister, where she honors, of course, the problem of hepatitis and its challenge medically. And there's a distant relation of mine, Dr. Dietrich, and Dr. Douglas Dietrich has worked on a cure for hepatitis, which can ultimately be utilized through a vaccination and injection process. Now, of course, vaccinations have their own controversy. I've described already their effectiveness in times before the onset of our pharmaceutical industry and its manipulation of vaccinations. So if Dr. Douglas Dietrich can somehow prevent it from being tainted by the pharmaceutical industry, industrial complex, the medical industrial complex is big pharma, then perhaps Douglas Dietrich with his cure for hepatitis can have an enormous impact on our immediate future with this terrible disease. So, you know, thank you very much for allowing me to talk about my distant friends and relations and all the rest of this, you know, Mr. Rex Barron. I hope that yours are doing well.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. This has been 3 hours of incredible information. I really appreciate you coming out here with us and look forward to speaking with you again sometime.
Look forward to it. My best to you and yours.
Daphne, you ready for a level 4 security clearance?
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Carl.
Yeah.
I feel like a red dot on your forehead.
Yeah, it's called adult acne. Thank you very much.
Are you hurt?
Are you strong?
No, honey, it's just a latte.
It burns, it burns.
Ethan Joseph! Let's run for Carl's house.
Get in the car.
We're gonna get in the car.
Guys, now.
When I count to three, you're gonna run, okay? One, two. Jeff!
Oh my God!
Guys, three!
Jeff, please, would you just get in the car?
How was I gonna have start?
On your wife? I don't think there's something off about them.
They're
both so overly accomplished and stylish.
Welcome to the Cobra Club.
A little different than you expected, huh?
That looks
like
a real snake.
Big one, that's real Cobra.
Do you have
ladies and gentlemen? Thank you very much for joining us this edition of LEAK Project. I'm your host, Rex Baer, and tonight's guest is Josh Reeves. From Dallas, Texas, he is a filmmaker, musician, radio talk show host, as well as researcher from theglobalreality.com. Now, through radio, videos, films, and even music, Josh Reeves presents his restless effort of research into matters concerning government corporate corruptions, the occult, esoteric philosophies, mass media, propaganda, even via alternative media. Social engineering, hidden technologies, ancient mysteries, religious spiritual manipulations, and more. Now, the global reality isn't corporate media or even mainline alternative media, but independent media. Now, he is the producer of the Secret Right series as well as Reality of Illusion series, and has a film just coming out, his latest work, The Spellcasters. During this discussion, we dive deep into the occult underbelly of Hollywood and the entertainment industry. Now, what if many of the truthers and conspiracy theorists were actually controlled opposition? What if the rabbit hole went so deep that there was no end? Is magic real or just a sleight of hand? Who are some of the key players and sorcerers controlling the deck of cards within the apex of control? Who are the real Illuminati puppet masters? Now, this is discussed and much more with Mr. Reeves. Also, make sure to become a member at leakproject.com. You will have access to exclusive content absolutely free. You can also get access to our shows via YouTube on youtube.com/clandestinetimelord. We even have a new channel. It's the William Wallace YouTube channel with content updated daily. Be the change you want to see. If you have a story or if there's information you want to hear about that we haven't touched on, make sure to send us an email, guestbookings@leakproject.com. You can also leave comments in the comments section, but I can't get to all of those because we get so many. So, guestbookings@leakproject.com. Talk to you soon. All right, Josh, thank you so much for joining us here at the Leak Project. How the heck are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Oh, absolutely. You know, talk about synchronicities. It sure is great that we have the opportunity to speak. And as I was telling you before we got started, I've had several requests to get you on the show, and it's just great that we finally can talk now. So if you would, please, tell our audience a little bit about yourself, and then let's jump into Spellcasters.
Well, I'm 40 years old. I'm from Dallas, Texas. I've been researching pretty much my whole life. I started researching UFOs and the Bermuda Triangle and weird stuff like that when I was in like the third grade, and it just kind of carried through and led interest into my teenage years. I started researching conspiracies and JFK and stuff when I was 15 or 16, and then just pretty much kept going on until then, and then things started to kind of come to a head around, you know, after 9/11 and whatnot, and that kind of got me thinking that, well, I've been researching all this stuff for many years, I need to start trying to do something about it. So I started working, you know, locally, trying to do local issues and stuff for years, and then got more into wanting to reach more people. Somebody suggested I do a radio show, and back in 2007, I started that and put out my first film that year. And as you mentioned, Spellcasters is my newest film. That's my sixth full-length film since 2007. And I've just been doing the radio show and going nonstop and trying to not only find the truth for myself, because that's what all this really started out for me. It started as a personal quest and a journey for the truth. And it never really, at first, struck me as something that a lot of people would be interested in, and when I finally decided that I had all this information and this knowledge that needed to be shared with people, that's when I started trying to put it out there, and it's been going ever since.
Yeah, that's fantastic. It sure is nice when you can do what you want to and make an impact at the same time. Now, you know, I think it's fascinating also that you're in Dallas. I'm going to be going out there in a few weeks because Uncle Eddie, great Uncle Eddie, and he's worked with NASA, CERN, different agencies. He's an inventor, and he's got multiple patents on night vision. And we're going to go out and do an interview with him and see some of the actual footage, because he made cameras that went to the moon. He made cameras that went around the world, and there's a lot of stuff on the internet right now, I guess you could say, kind of psyop, essentially, about the flat earth theory, whether you know, believe it or not. I certainly don't believe in it, but some people, they'll talk to you for hours, and hey, that's cool, they're more than welcome to their own opinion. But if you could actually see footage of somebody going around the world, and if you've got a connection like that, then you know that's pretty good evidence in my opinion. I don't think he's lying to me, but you know, I certainly want to hear about the spellcasters because, I mean, that's awesome. I think of spellcasters, I'm thinking of the people behind the scenes that kind of orchestrate and influence the majority of what people are involved in.
Well, absolutely. That's what it is, and it also gets into that at all levels. You mentioned there with some of the psyop stuff. We definitely tackle all of that in this film and get on into the stuff that pertains to something that's been going on, as you mentioned, the overall reaching control scheme, but also things that, you know, certain people who are said to be truth tellers and things of that nature. I'm not one of those flat earth people. You don't have to worry about that or walking on eggshells around that with me, because I'm not on board with that. And I saw it for what it was as soon as it came out. It's obviously a psyop, and when you go and research it and research where it originated from, the people who started putting it out recently, as well as where it's always come from, it always traces back to Masonic sources and other people who have been known to put out disinformation. I don't really tackle a flat earth in the smoke capture. At the very end of the movie, I mention it in relation to some other information, because that's really what the film tackles most of all. It gets into the entire history of mind control and MK Ultra, but also Scientology and how that all relates to this system, as you mentioned, of control, which really seems to have started to come to fruition in the year 1947. So I think that one of the things that people are going to take away from this film is, even though there might be things in there that they didn't know, I think the way that I'm presenting this to people and showing them that, yes, as you mentioned, these people, this is not just a nickname. The people behind the scenes, the controllers and puppet masters, these people literally are into black magic and the occult and the rest of it. And so we really show that. We show how that connects to Scientology, the truth movement. I don't want to give too much away because I want people to see the film, but I also want them to realize that this is not not really like anything else they've ever seen.
Absolutely. That's great. And, you know, it's interesting also because anybody that knows about intelligence agencies and many of those that have been affiliated with the Department of Defense at certain levels, they'll go to school and learn about mysticism and hermetics and what people might consider magic with a K. I'm not talking about Crowleyan magic, but not your stage magic where you go up and pull a rabbit out of a hat, essentially.
Right.
So, you know, and that's fascinating because really, if you think about it, to a certain degree, magic is essentially creating something by a thought first. So in that sense, anything can be magic, but these guys take it to a whole other level. I mean, they know how to orchestrate global agendas, and with their Hollywood mind control and how they've just mastered the MK Ultra techniques and stuff, I'm sure, with the high definition 4K TV. I can't even imagine what they're doing to people's subconscious minds, and I've been trained to study what happens to the subconscious mind via media.
Well, that's exactly what it is, and we get into a lot of that in the film, and you're absolutely right. The techniques that have been utilized have evolved, and it absolutely is at the core of it, black magic, and we show that in this film. You know, people who are in the intelligence agencies, oftentimes, as you mentioned, these guys go and study and actually are, as part of their, as you mentioned, part of their required courses that they take. You know, they might go and take...
The model year in clear-out is going on now at G. Messer Ford. The 2017s are on their way, and every 2016 must go now. We're making the deals that other dealers won't. Get $12,000 off the MSRP on new 2016 F-150 and Super Duty. Voted best in Lubbock because nobody beats a G. Messer Ford deal. That's right, nobody. Get your clear-out...
their required courses that they take. You know, they might go and take, you know, sharpshooting or something else, but as you mentioned, in there, you're also going to have the magical training and the indoctrination that goes with that. And we see this at the highest levels of the CIA. There were guys even before the formation of the CIA with the Office of Strategic Services that were into all this, and even into the modern day. This is not something that's changed. So that was fascinating for me, and it was fascinating to find out and look at all the information pertaining to the CIA and Department of Defense connections to Scientology, and see how these things are not separate. They're all a part of the same thing, and that's what we have to understand, because I think oftentimes there's a lot of separation and a lot of stuff that goes on with a lot of these different topics of research. And I think sometimes people have difficulty seeing how they all come together and form the greater whole picture we're all trying to get at. So I think that's what I really try to do with this film.
You know, another thing that I'm wondering, I'm on your website right now, theglobalreality.com, great website, by the way. When you first started getting into the dark side of reality, essentially started studying the clandestine hand and stuff, how long have you been putting films together? Because you said this is your sixth film?
Yeah, I put out my first film in 2007, so this is my sixth full-length film in 9 years.
And what was your, let's talk about some of your other films as well. I know you don't want to give too much out on the Spellcasters. Maybe we could dive into a few other ones, and then we'll go also back to the Spellcasters here shortly.
Cool. Well, the first film I ever put out was in 2007. That was called 9/11 New World Rising. It was, at the time, I'd seen a few 9/11 films. I thought there was stuff in there that hadn't been, at that point, there was stuff that hadn't been put in a movie yet. It's been in a million stuff now. So that was kind of my thing behind putting that out. And this kind of goes along with the story of the Spellcasters, because at that time I was very much into the truth movement and thought it was, you know, legit and all on the up and up. And then I put out my film, and a couple of weeks after putting that film out, I started my radio show, and I had on a person by the name of Peter Dale Scott, and we were talking about different think tanks and groups like the Council on Foreign Relations and the Bilderberg Group and these things, and he said, well, you know, those groups are really not as powerful anymore. The group you need to look into is this group called the Council for National Policy. And I was taken aback, because at that time I really thought I kind of knew something about stuff. And the more you learn, the more you realize you don't know anything. So I had never heard of this group and immediately started researching it and started noticing that a lot of these people who are members and connected to this group, it's very hard to find a lot of current membership lists because they keep their membership totally secret. But just the ones I could find from older membership lists from like 1998 had, you know, not just one or two, but five or six, seven people I had seen on stuff like Alex Jones' radio show. I'd seen these guests, and I started going, wait a second here. This is very strange, and I couldn't find anybody talking about it. So that led me to researching this group, the Council for National Policy, and making my second film, which came out in 2009, called The Secret Right, Volume 1, where I detail all this. And then in 2011, I put out Volume 2, which dug deeper into it. And then I kind of moved away from that in the following year. And then in 2013, I put out The Lost Secrets of Ancient America, Volume 1, which gets into my research into this ancient rock wall in Rockwall, Texas, and other evidence of ancient cultures being found all around the United States. And I followed that up in 2014 with Volume 2. And both of those movies together, Volume 1 and Volume 2, The Lost Secrets, are almost 6 hours total. So they're just jam-packed with info. And again, I was kind of wanting to move away from those topics for a minute before I got into making The Lost Secrets of Ancient America, Volume 3. And that's what led me to this most recent film, The Spellcasters, which really just started out as a film that was going to expose Hollywood. And then, as most of these films always do every time I make one, it just ballooned into something beyond what I expected, and I started finding all these connections again back to the same people I had exposed in the Secret Right, Volume 1 and 2, connections back to the CNP type, Scientology, and that's, you know, that leads us to now. So my journey with all of these films and everything has been relatable to the other. The only one that doesn't really relate to all the rest of them would be the first one, the 9/11 New World Rising one, but the Secret Right films all the way through to the Spellcasters, those are films that all really have information that all nexuses back. And then, of course, I've made a lot of mini films. I put out one at the beginning of the year called Secret Messages, Volume 1 and 2, dealing with David Bowie stuff and Stanley Kubrick and a lot of weird stuff. So those are up there on YouTube as well.
Yeah, let's talk about David Bowie for a second if we can. But first, I got to know where this ancient rock wall is in Texas. I'm going.
Well, you can't go see it. I mean, it's buried. There's nothing to see. It's buried underneath the town. There's nowhere exposed. If you're not aware of this information, I'll send you a copy. You definitely need to watch my Lost Secrets of Ancient America, Volume 1, because it's the first film that's ever been made on the Rock Wall, just like the Secret Right, Volume 1 and Volume 2 are the first films that have ever been made on the Council for National Policy. So that's what I always try to do with my films. I look at the things that people aren't talking about and things that needed to have a film made about it, and then that's what I make my mission. And that's what this Rockwall thing started out for me, because I grew up not far from there and had many strange experiences my whole life, and so did a lot of people that I know right around this area, everything from UFO sightings, missing time. And when I first found out about this Rockwall thing, I don't know what it was, I can't explain it to you, I've never experienced this before in my life, but just instantly, as soon as I read the words. I read it in the book, and it said, the ancient, maybe one day we'll find all the answers to the questions we have, such as this, this, and this, and the ancient Rockwall in Rockwall, Texas. And something just clicked in my head as soon as I read that line, and I knew, even though I had no evidence to back it up yet, I just knew that was connected to these strange experiences that I'd had my whole life around this area. And absolutely, I was right. I mean, we're talking about possibly the oldest civilization ever found on Earth. We're talking about construction techniques that were used in this thing to create the stones that we have nowhere near the technology. I mean, it's made of all these precious stones and tourmaline, and it's got rare earth metals in it, things that would have to be extracted. I mean, one of the major things it has in it is niobium. And if you look up what niobium is, we use it in modern-day structural engineering. We use it in rocket engines. We use it in things like CERN. It basically allows you to produce a great amount of conductivity without a lot of heat. Now, niobium is only found in an element called columbite. We didn't start using it until about 200 years ago. You can't get niobium without extracting it from this element called columbite. Well, coincidentally, there's no columbite whatsoever found in any of these rock wall stones, meaning it had to have been extracted by someone. But here's the thing. Geologists who have looked at this thing say that it could not have been created in Earth's current gravity. We're talking about something that's upwards of 432,000 years old. So if people want to get more information on that, they can watch my Lost Secrets of Ancient America Volume 1 film is really the one. It's almost 4 hours, and it's got all the rock wall stuff in there. And Volume 2, what I wanted to do was I wanted to, when I started looking into this rock wall thing, I said, okay, if this is real, and this is what I think it is, other things like this had to have been found across the country. And that was where even though I had enough.
Get back to it.